Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Managing the Millennials, Second Edition. Discover the core competencies for managing today's workforce. By Mick Ukleja and Chip Espinoza. Narrated by Mike Lenz. Forward. Gabrielle Jackson Boucher, author, Five Millennial Myths, the handbook for managing and motivating millennials. Can't we just skip millennials and start hiring the next generation? Admit it, the thought has crossed your mind. And guess what? You're not alone. I'm asked this question nearly every time I get on stage to speak about millennials and leadership. Today's millennials are painted as entertainment-addicted, entitled 20-somethings, who can't look up from their smartphone to shake your hand. Millennials aren't the first generation of youth to get a bad rap. If stereotypes were true, every Gen Xer was a grunge kid. Every baby boomer was a useless hippie. Every traditionalist was a good-for-nothing greaser. Generations are not created in a vacuum. They are the imperfect production of parents, pop culture, and politics. Millennials were born into an economic boom and graduated into a major bust. We were raised on the internet. We live in a world where knowledge is borderless, and information platforms keep facts fluid. Today, managers look at this generation with amusement and confusion. To them, we are terrifying, strange, and inspiring. A quick Google search on millennials, and your browser is flooded with headlines. Millennials expect a raise and promotion in year one. Here come the millennials. Are you ready for their ego? Expecting loyalty from Gen Y may be expecting too much. The critics have it wrong. When I look at my generation, I don't see selfish, lazy, and flaky kids. I see individuals passionate about justice, committed to making a difference, and ready to be taken seriously. Millennials refuse to accept the status quo. We want careers that crisscross industries. We trust leaders with raw authenticity. We crave experiences that last more than moments. Our favorite verbs are disrupt, dream, digitize, and sustain. I graduated from college in 2009. It was the height of the recession, and well-paying jobs were hard, i.e., impossible to come by. But by some luck, I had found one. I would be working in a political consulting firm, preparing for a statewide election in California. It was my first day on the job. 4 weeks prior, I was walking across the graduation stage. That day, I was walking into the rest of my life. Looking behind me, I saw the faces of my parents cheering me on. I could feel the support of my professors and the pressure to make them proud. I put one foot in front of the other as I passed through huge glass doors and into my destiny. The receptionist greeted me in the lobby and asked me to follow her to my office. I have an office? My friends are still taking fancy coffee orders, and I have my own office. Before I could decide on a color scheme for my new workspace, the receptionist stopped in front of a closed door and pointed, "There you go. Let me know if you need anything." I looked at the door with anticipation. This was it. I cracked the door and pushed. Before I could rush into my magnificent working quarters, I was hit like a wave with the overwhelming stench of bleach detergent. There it was, my office. Formerly a cleaning closet, it was now my very own productivity center. Once the fumes subsided, I sat down and made myself at home. I had no idea what I would be doing or what I would be working on, but in that moment, I had made it. Work was not what I had expected. Office hours were long. Project assignments were complicated. The culture was foreign and boring. 6 months later, my manager noticed my mood had changed. He pulled me into his office and did something incredible. He said, "Gabrielle, I know that you probably aren't doing the work you thought you would be doing. I'm sure it isn't as fun or as exciting as you were anticipating." I tried not to agree with him. Was I getting fired? He continued, "But I just wanted to say thank you. When you serve your clients better, it helps all of us serve our clients too. So, thanks." That was it. It took 60 seconds to change my understanding of management forever. Managing the Millennials will have a similar impact on anyone who listens to it. Chip and Mick have investigated the motivational forces that drive millennial performance. They have conducted primary research to collect firsthand data on how millennials communicate. They have developed profound resources for leaders of every industry to create a more generationally inclusive environment. I want to applaud you for choosing this book. It is the first step to a journey of creating awesomeness at work. Organizations that apply the contents of this book are excelling in their industry, while businesses that refuse to embrace it are being left in the dust. The only place there is a generation gap is in our heads. Working with corporate management teams has taught me that every employee wants what millennials want: fulfillment, recognition, appreciation, and compensation. This book will provide you with incredible insight into managing the next generation. But more than just managing millennials, this book will fundamentally change how you lead and relate to others. Get ready to have your mind and your influence rocked. Get ready to finally understand the millennials. Introduction. Close encounters with a different kind. Raise your hand if you've ever had an encounter at work with a younger employee that left you completely puzzled. Relax, you are not alone. There are currently four generations at work: builders, baby boomers, Gen X, and millennials. And three of the generations have been playing nice together for well over a decade. Therefore, our attention will focus on where most of the angst lies: between the new kids on the block, millennials, and the other age cohorts. We are constantly amazed at how the topic of managing the millennials resonates with people. Standing in line for a latte, on a plane, or at a cocktail party, when we talk about our research, it creates a buzz. Although interested in hearing about our findings, people are even more eager to tell their own story. Odds are that if you bought this book, you have your own story, you have lived it, and you have experienced the tension. A few years ago, we began to notice a growing frustration among managers and business leaders with integrating younger workers into their organizations. Activities that in the past had been relatively straightforward, like recruiting, retaining, and rewarding, now seemed more challenging than ever. And we were not the only ones who noticed. Newspapers, journals, magazines, niche publications, 60 Minutes, and even movies have captured the phenomena of the millennial in the workplace. The stories portrayed reactions that ranged from amazement to incredulity to outrage. These reactions are the result of values and behaviors exhibited by millennial employees, which cause them to appear distinctly different from their vocational forerunners, and which are undermining norms that have supported the workplace for decades. This book is the result of a 2-year study to find out how managers can be successful with their millennial employees in the face of these challenges. We wanted to get inside the relational dynamics. Our objective was to identify behaviors and traits exhibited by millennials that managers deemed problematic. We interviewed hundreds of managers and employees in a variety of work environments. Data from the interviews were used to build a model, which we explain in the following chapters. The model illustrates the different values held by each generation. It also shows how behaviors exhibited by the holders of those values are often misperceived, and how those misperceptions in turn lead to intergenerational tension. We explain why generations have differing values, and how such values manifest through behaviors and interactions that create tension in the workplace. Specifically, we identify 9 points of tension that result from clashing value systems in a cross-generational management context, and 9 competencies required to mitigate each counterproductive disconnect. We have committed a chapter to each of the competencies. Each chapter describes the tension, potential disconnect, and the competency that leads to generational rapport. Our mission is not just to describe the conflict. We go beyond that, to provide tools for resolving the tension that inhibits the success of both managers and millennials. If you're a listener of management literature, then you are familiar with many of the managerial leader practices in this book. Some practices are familiar, while others are novel, but all have received respect in academic and practitioner literatures. However, concepts and models are only helpful if you know where and how to apply them. The value of our work is to help you identify the areas that can undermine your success as a manager and what to do about these areas. Most of the managers who have attended our workshops have commented that managing the millennials is useful for managing all ages. We agree. As it happens, the solutions that we share include best practices that can be applied in many relational settings. However, there is special urgency in the multi-generational context, and especially so with millennial employees. Demographers William Strauss and Neil Howe reference the Harry Potter series as an excellent illustration for the differences between millennials and their predecessors, builders, baby boomers, and Gen X. Harry Potter and his friends are smart, overachieving, innovative, and self-possessed, doing their best to operate within the rules set forth for them, while practicing their calling of saving the world as need arises. They represent millennials. The individualistic, judgmental, egotistical teachers at Hogwarts, responsible for shaping the young wizards, characterize the baby boomer generation. Characters like Hagrid, though not in power but always around to help, epitomize Generation X, a group sandwiched between two powerful and dominant generations. Unlike any other generation before them, millennials are the first generation that can access information without an authority figure. They are wizards with technology, visionaries with high expectations. Armed with knowledge or the know-how to access it, they proclaim themselves as ready. Ready for any challenge, ready for more responsibility, and, as John Mayer sings, waiting on the world to change. They perceive themselves to be in waiting, held back by well-meaning elders whose best years have come and gone. Millennials respect their elders for what they have done, but relegate their future utility to the role of mentor, career counselor, and cheerleader. At the core of the millennial phenomenon is that they do not have the same need or know-how to build relationships with their managers or authority figures. Previous generations had to take initiative to relationally connect in order to gain information and access. It's a natural arrangement that has played itself out for generations. Things are different now. The rules have changed. A millennial with a smartphone can usurp the authority of a decorated professor in her own classroom. Builders, baby boomers, and Gen X cannot help but sense the shift and ask themselves, why don't they ever come and ask me questions? We suggest that either they do not think they need to, or they do not know how. The dichotomy is that they desperately want mentors or career advocates. That leads us to believe that most millennials just do not know how to relate to someone who is in authority that is not already perceived to be for them. Since Managing the Millennials was first published, we have discovered that the millennial phenomenon is observed and experienced throughout the world. We will address the international picture in the next chapter. The other side of the coin is that managers do not recall the experience of their superiors reaching out to them. It's a behavior they do not remember being modeled to them. They know why and how to reach upward, but do not feel the need to reach downward, or they just do not know how. And for good reason. Traditional managerial leader training programs focus on how managers can get subordinates to do what she or he wants them to do. One of the first questions that surfaces from an audience is, how can you help me change them, the millennials? Although we devote a great deal of attention to the values, attitudes, and behaviors of millennial employees, our story is not about them. The lead character in our story is the manager, the person responsible for the productivity of, development of, and knowledge transfer to the emerging workforce. In the chapters that follow, we characterize how the managers in our study experience millennials on the job. The managers and leaders we worked with expressed both admiration and frustration. We preserve their expressions unedited in order to illustrate both the barriers to and opportunities for adaptation, engagement, and communication. Because the managers' expressions are unedited, we've chosen to omit their names in an effort to provide anonymity. You notice that we do not use company names. companies are often used to promote and legitimize managerial concepts. Our work is legitimized by the everyday experiences of managers. This book challenges both how you think about management and how you manage. Those who are willing to adapt will reap great benefits, both personally and professionally. Understandably, many managers are reluctant to take on the added burden of learning and practicing a new set of skills required to be adaptive to the challenges presented by millennial employees. One of the most frequent refrains we heard from managers who were reluctant to accept this burden was, "They, millennials, just need to grow up, just like any other generation." The most important question in this book can only be answered by you. Are you willing to adapt? When it comes to managing millennials, it is our belief that the people with the most maturity will have to adapt first. We are saying that you are the key to your own success, your organization's success, and ultimately, the success of the millennials. As a point of clarification, we acknowledge that managing and leading are two different functions, but because they are often performed by the same person, we use the terms interchangeably. Part 1. The Millennial Phenomenon. Chapter 1. The Millennials and You. If we don't like a job, we quit, because the worst thing that can happen is that we move back home. There's no stigma, and many of us grew up with both parents working, so our moms would love nothing more than to cook our favorite meatloaf. Jason Ryan Dorsey, 28 years old. Have you noticed the change in your workplace? Young people, particularly members of a new generation of workers that we refer to as millennials, have recently become the largest age cohort in the workforce. Are you ready for them? And have you noticed that they are a little different than you? You might even think they are strange or that they do not quite have it together. Maybe they sometimes show up to work wearing flip-flops, or they have iPod headphones hanging from their ears. And perhaps they just sit at their desks, waiting for someone to give them something to do. In 2015, millennials comprised 35% of the workforce, nearly 54 million. Within the next decade, millennials will be all in. By 2020, 1 in 3 adults will be a millennial. And when the clock clicks 2025, 3 of 4 workers will be from the millennial generation. Successful managers will be the ones who understand, appreciate, and learn to work with the differences in values, work-life priorities, and expectations they bring. The millennial flood has become front-page news. Virtually every form of media is talking about it, from the Saturday Night Live sketch The Millennials to newspapers to niche magazines and journals. USA Today had this to say on the topic. Businesses are struggling to keep pace with the new generation of young people entering the workforce who have starkly different attitudes and desires than employees over the past few decades. Human Resource Executive says, millennials, people primarily in their 20s, are entering the workforce bringing with them new promises and challenges for HR, not to mention a whole new way of working. Clearly, something has changed from previous generations to this newest generation of 20-somethings, and management is worried that the change is not all good. Let us say that you run a corporation. Who is going to take over for you when you're gone? Do you think the next generation is ready to take over? Or perhaps you run a family business. Do you think your kids are ready to step into that role? Guess what? Today is the tomorrow you worried about yesterday. It is here. Now. The new generation of 20-somethings has seen the help wanted signs in our windows. They know we really need them. And guess what? They need us just as much as we need them. So the thing to do is to reach out and get to know them. What motivates them? What do they think? How do they learn? What do they expect? Why reach out? Because we each have what the other really wants and needs. And because our success and the success of our organizations depends on it. The generations at work. But aren't all youth the same? The answer to that is yes and no. There are some common characteristics of all youth, whether they were born 100 years ago or just a decade ago. Before we address whether all youth are the same, let's briefly outline the four generations currently in the workplace. In our training sessions, we do an exercise where we break into groups and have the participants talk about the clothing they wore, the music they listened to, the socio-political events they remember, and the technology they used in their adolescence and young adulthood. You can imagine how quickly people start to compare their experiences. In one of our sessions, a builder, a person born from 1925 through the end of World War II to 1945, told of how her family shared a telephone with other families in the area. Few people today remember that sharing a phone line was referred to as a party line. A millennial pulled a smartphone out of his pocket and said, "This is my party line. I can connect to five people at once." The builders. There were 56 million builders. The Great Depression, Roosevelt's New Deal, the Korean War, World War II, the GI Bill, all left an indelible stamp on the members of this generation. As a result of the GI Bill, 49% of those admitted into college in 1947 were veterans. By 1956, nearly 8 million World War II veterans had taken advantage of the opportunity to further their education. Authority was important, as was hard work, honor, and delayed gratification. People were willing to work 30 years or more before they got their gold watch and could retire. It was not uncommon to spend one's entire career at one company. The baby boomers. Then along came the next generation, the baby boomers, born from 1946 to 1964, numbering 80 million or so men and women. Vietnam, the Cold War, the Civil Rights Movement, the Women's Liberation Movement, television, and rock and roll all made an indelible impression on this generation. The baby boomers protested in favor of equality for everybody, and they discovered the charms of credit cards, which drove their builder parents crazy. Builders learned from the Depression not to buy on credit. The Kennedy and King assassinations robbed them of their innocence, while the moon landing showed the world they could do anything they set their minds to. For the baby boomers, values such as professional identity, health and wellness, and material wealth are all very important. Boomers are forever young, run fast, jump long, and throw hard. They wanted free drugs in the 1960s, and now they want free drugs again, this time from Medicare. Because they find much of their identity in their work, it's no surprise that baby boomers have added 1 month per year to the work week. When it comes to technology, they use it to do more work, not less. Generation X. Then along came another group, Generation X, born from 1965 to 1979, which numbers 61 million. Gen Xers were influenced by more recent events, such as the Persian Gulf War, the Challenger explosion, AIDS, corporate downsizing, a tripling of the divorce rate, both parents working, latchkey kids, video games, MTV, computers, all made their mark on this generation. They were suspicious of their parents. They say, "Wait a minute, you mean you can land a man on the moon and yet you can't even get a rocket off the launch pad?" They witnessed environmental disasters such as Chernobyl and Three Mile Island. Gen X was coming of age during the Watergate scandal that led to the impeachment of President Richard M. Nixon. Some of the values that emerged from their experience include mobility and autonomy. They need to be independent. Their greatest value is to have balance in their lives. Technology came of age, and the members of this generation use it for work-life balance. They don't perceive a need to be in the office. They could sit on the beach and do their work. The Millennials. Today, there's a new generation known as Millennials, aka Gen Y. Demographers placed their birth years between 1980 and 2000. There are 92 million millennials. They have been shaped by 9/11 and terrorism, Columbine, which took the King and Kennedy assassinations to a new and more personal level, environmentalism, cell phones, text messaging, technology-based social networking, and a strong emphasis on social responsibility. Technology isn't a tool to just do more work or to achieve work-life blending. It's an integral part of the members of this group, and working with it has become second nature. The members of this new generation want and need constant feedback. Why? Because they were raised in democratic and praise-based families that proudly displayed "My kid made the honor roll" bumper stickers. They grew up in an era where the focus of parenting was nurturing. They've grown up working on teams in school and on academic projects. When they get into the workforce, they expect to work in teams. Diversity is important to them. If they walk into the workplace and don't see diversity, they think something is wrong. Millennials are the most educated and technologically savvy generation ever, and arguably a highly sheltered and structured generation. 1 in 3 is not Caucasian. 1 in 4 comes from a single-parent home. 3 in 4 have working mothers. And in two-parent homes, children get more time with parents than they did 25 years ago. The next generation. The next generation clock started in 2001 and will continue through the second decade of the 21st century. The future will determine how they will be referred to, but for now, some refer to them as Gen Z, IY, and Homeland. In our first edition, we named the next generation Generation O for President Obama. We soon discovered we were the only ones using the term. The forerunners in the group turned 15 years old in 2016. Their cohort will be smaller than that of the millennials. Here are some of the things that may impact their values and attitudes: mortgage crisis, corporate bailouts, Sully and U.S. Airways Flight 1549, Captain Phillips thwarts Somalian pirates, and ISIS. What in the world is happening? Much to our amazement, after Managing the Millennials was originally released, the first companies that invited us to help them were multinationals, experiencing generational tension throughout their worldwide operations. The first invitations to keynote were from places such as China, India, Mexico, Brazil, Philippines, and the United Kingdom. Although our initial research was conducted in North American organizations, our finding struck a chord around the world. It could be argued that in countries experiencing great sociological and economic shifts, such as China and India, disconnects between manager and millennial can be even greater. China started the move toward economic liberalization in 1978, and India followed suit in 1991, when the first wave of millennials were being born. Think about it. Managers who grew up under communism or socialism, their career expectations at age 20-something were very different from those of the millennials they encounter today. The managers have little or no context for relating to the optimism and career expectations of the millennials they manage. One multinational client, based in the United States, claims the biggest challenge they have with respect to generational issues is in its Mexico operations. Our point is further illustrated in the following story by Jane Bird in the Financial Times International about a Moscow University student and what he desires from work. 5 years ago, when Denis Baranov was studying computer science at university in Moscow, he began working part-time for Data Art, a U.S.-based technology consulting company. After graduating, he continued working remotely for the company for 2 years while traveling. He is now a full-time employee in Data Art's London office and is able to persuade his employer to send him to conferences that also help with his PhD studies. This freedom and flexibility is a big attraction to the job, he says. I also value being able to collaborate with colleagues based in locations such as New York and Argentina, says Mr. Baranov. And I like being able to learn something new every day. For example, I am currently adapting our mobile technology for wearable devices. At 26, Mr. Baranov is a typical millennial, those whose birth dates range from the 1980s to the early 2000s. Members of this generation expect their jobs to be challenging, creative, and dynamic, says Maggie Stilwell, UK and Ireland managing partner for talent at the consultancy EY, which published a global generational survey this year. Millennials are a confident bunch who want to develop their own skills and passions outside work, says Ms. Stilwell. Organizations that are not flexible will lose employees. The African Journal of Business Management published an article by Tay Angeline entitled Managing Generational Diversity at the Workplace: Expectations and Perceptions of Different Generational Employees. Angeline argues the lack of a mutual understanding of expectations and the unawareness of unintentional perceptions cause intergenerational conflict. Sound familiar? How about Alistair Ross's work in the United Kingdom? There were difficulties in communication with older generations, and many young people described their generation as having different values to those of their parents and grandparents. Millennials are truly a worldwide phenomenon. Almost half of the works citing our book are international publications. Here's a brief list of titles. Generational Cohorts, Expectations in the Workplace, A Study of New Zealanders, by Kristen Murray and Paul Towson. Perceptions of Age Generations Regarding Employee Satisfaction in a South African Organization, University of South Africa Institutional Repository, by Nico Martens and Ellen Martens. Managing Generation Y Occupational Therapists, Optimizing Their Potential, Australian Occupational Therapy Journal, by Caroline Hills, Susan Ryan, Helen Warren Forward, and Derek Smith. The Impact of a Performance Management System on Service Delivery in the City of Johannesburg Metropolitan Municipality, by Patrick Kina Radaby. Creating Generation-Y Sources of Motivation for Enhanced Performance, Turin Yliopisto, University of Turku, Finland, by Suvi Latinmaki. The Effect of a Multi-Generational Workforce on Employee Productivity, a Case Study of Kenya Electricity Generating Company, by Joan Mwangi Ngeshi. Generation Gap Management in Restructured Metallurgical Enterprises in Poland, by Bozina Gajzik and Jan Zimzal. The Embryonic Challenge from Gen Y Calling for SOS in Banking Industry, a Call for Action for HR Practitioner in Indonesia, by Irving Luntungen, Ada Vitalia Hubis, Yuis Sunarti, and Agis Molana. Retaining the Millennial Generation Within the Canadian Public Sector, by Natasha Melnichuk. Millennials are more alike around the world than any generation that has preceded them. If you pick up an organizational textbook, globalization and technological advancement are presented as two of the top challenges for companies in the 21st century. Ironically, millennials have also been called globals and digital natives. Let's revisit Carl Mannheim's theory that generations are a sociological construct. He suggested that a generational worldview could be shaped when people of a similar age, primarily adolescents, and geographical location experience socio-political events together. Mannheim offered his theory almost 100 years ago. Because of globalization and technology, in many ways, the world is much smaller today. If Mannheim were writing in this era, he might be minimizing the geographical and emphasizing the technological context of generation. Perhaps worldview is no longer limited by geography. Technology is the new context for shaping a generation. We have made the point that because of technology, millennials are the first generation that has not needed an authority figure to access information. And therefore, the dynamics of relationship to power have shifted. Now we see it worldwide. We would like to point out a celebrated body of research that has to do with understanding the differences between cultures. One of the more noted sociologists of the 20th century, although he did not want to be pigeonholed as such, Geert Hofstede conducted research he referred to as Dimensions of Culture. He sought to identify the cultural differences among countries. One of the dimensions in his work is power distance. People in societies exhibiting a large degree of power distance accept a hierarchical order in which everybody has a place and which needs no further justification. In a low power distance environment, it is more acceptable for a subordinate to challenge a superior. In a high-power, distance culture, it is less acceptable for a subordinate to disagree with a superior. Companies and countries that have long been considered high-power distance are finding their young employees challenging management about time off, promotions, and the need for flexibility. As stated earlier, one multinational company is experiencing more tension between management and millennials in Mexico, a high-power distance country, than in the United States, a low-power distance country. Japan, another high-power distance country, is seeing its millennials, referred to as the Yutori generation, decline when their supervisor asks them to go out for dinner or golfing. Previous generations would never dream of doing such a thing. The Yutori generation prefers to build strong relationships with their peers, such as friends and coworkers, and not with their supervisors. We're not arguing that there are no differences between millennials around the world, just as we would not argue that every millennial in the United States is the same. For instance, the Yutori generation is smaller than the baby boomer and Gen X age cohorts in Japan. The label Yutori comes from an educational philosophy implemented in 1998. Yutori originally means not to hurry, go slowly, or take your time. So the Yutori teaching method is do not educate too much and give children more latitude. The Yutori movement was a response to a system that emphasized discipline, rote learning, and inflexibility in instruction. Many Japanese people have the distinct impression that the Yutori generation is too quiet and passive.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.